Hi, good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for joining Accrets International Webinar 2021. Is server virtualization still good enough? My name is Hayoung, and welcome to our webinar. So before we start our webinar, if you have any questions, please feel free to leave your questions from live event Q&A session. You may just click on the question mark icon on the top right-hand corner and click on Ask Question to make any inquiries. So this is the brief schedule of today's webinar. We will take a 5 minutes of break before continuing our presentation, which will be the demo of the OpenStack, followed by Q&A sessions. So Q&A session will be led by my manager, Joshua, later on. So let me briefly introduce our two speakers who is going to speak for today's webinar. Ting Yao will be the main speaker of today's webinar. Ting Yao is IT professional with decades of experience in large corporations architecting, deploying, and operating diverse technology solutions. Ting Yao also in-depth domain knowledge in banking, telecommunication, oil and gas, media, and etc. So next, Corey is going to show the demo of OpenStack. Corey is an IT consultant with over 15 years industry experience, specializes in enterprise and data center infrastructure. Corey has worked closely with OpenStack and SEF for the past 6 years and has designed and deployed many clusters for public cloud and private cloud scenarios. So this was brief introduction of our speakers. Now I will pass to our speaker, Ting Yao, to start our webinar.
Thanks, Hayoung. Let me share my content. Are you able to see my content already? No? Are you able to see my content? No?
Yes, we can see your content.
The presentation slide, is it?
Yes.
Okay. Right, let me enlarge the screen. Okay, welcome everybody again. Thanks for taking the time to attend our webinar. Again, if you have any questions, please do post the questions on the Q&A. Otherwise, we also have a Q&A session later today. Okay, let's move on to... Oh, sorry. Let me skip a few slides. Okay, let me first discuss the brief history of computing. Okay, this brief history is my own view. It's not really a history kind of stuff, but basically this is a brief history of where we are in the infrastructure kind of world. Okay, you guys may know that you know, the first computer is actually an analog computer. Yeah, and this was created by Charles Babbage. Okay, it's called analytical engine. And I think this is the first computing device in the world at that time. Okay, then actually we move on to the next one, which you can see this is a section of a vacuum tube kind of computer. Actually, the whole computer is about 18,000 vacuum tubes and actually fills a room of about 20 to 40 feet. So it's huge. And I think the processing capability of this guy is probably less than our calculator now. Next comes the birth of the transistor computer. Okay, the fully transistorized computer in Europe was built by the Atomic Energy Research in the UK. Okay, so everything is transistor, no more vacuum tube. Well, then I think we come to the modern Unix machine. I think Sun started in 1982 and developed the Sun 1, which is a Unix box for computing. And the first OS is Sun OS 0.9. Okay, it's a port from Unisoft. Okay. Right, then I think we come to the computing era now, which I think is the last 20 years. Okay, a lot of things has changed since day one, the analog computer. Basically, in this era, which is this 20 years, we see a lot of improvement in the IT in terms of application, infrastructure, computing power, and so on. Okay, I think what defines this period to me is basically hardware abstraction and virtualization. Okay, in 1998, actually VMware was formed, and I myself was very intrigued, when I received my first version of VMware workstation. Okay, I was able to load many OS, and I was able to play around with different kind of software, even though I only have one laptop. Okay, so that was server, that was basically workstation virtualization. And later in 2001, actually VMware released the GXX server. And from then onwards, most servers are moving towards virtual machines. Okay, also by the turn of the century, which is 2000 thereabout, switch network also dominated the landscape. Okay, the born of the VLAN was there, but VLAN was a little bit, they can only support about 4,000 segments, so it's a little bit restrictive. Okay, so later on, they have this specification called RFC 7348, which is actually an overlay encapsulation protocol, and they can actually support up to 16 million segments. This is where it becomes then possible to have cloud services where you have pool resources and things of that nature. Okay, storage virtualization was a long time. Actually, basically, it bunched together a bunch of these optical devices, and then present it to the server as a single storage. Okay, but storage virtualization has also moved very fast. And now, if you are all aware that there is a lot of technology out there, for example, Nutanix, they have their own software-defined storage. VMware also have their own software-defined storage, which they call vSAN, and more on the open source side itself, which Corey is the expert in this area. Okay, let me move on to the next slide. Okay, this is a also the beginning of cloud. I think in 2009, if I'm not wrong, AWS started their services, and I think they were the first public cloud. During that period, actually, I was still working for HP. And basically, HP is very much a traditional company. We don't have intention to start up public cloud. Okay. I think in year 20, probably 2011 or 12, we started doing private cloud, for the for the enterprise customer. Yeah, but I think we weren't that successful then. Okay, as you all know now, I think you know, there are use cases for both public cloud as well as private cloud. And you know, we need to know exactly what we want you know, the services to be like. Okay, not everything is suitable for public cloud, not everything is suitable for private cloud. So I think a mix will be what generally most corporations go for. Okay, in terms of cloud computing services, there are basically three types. One is the IaaS, which is the infrastructure as a service. The other one is platform as a service, and the third one is software as a service. I think for Accrets, we have developed a offering in the infrastructure as a service. We also have developed a software, and we are going to launch it as a software as a service pretty soon. I think Hayoung is also in charge of the project, and probably, you know, sometime later she wants to create a webinar for that. Okay, platform as a service is something that we are not offering now, but we are looking at doing it maybe in year 2022. And I think that would be kind of a future, because you know, nowadays a lot of application, cloud native application, is developed in microservices. Okay, and in order to keep up with the new cloud native application, we are likely to develop something for the platform as a service in 2022. Okay, so let's move on. Okay, why we virtualize servers? Yeah, I my own experience of virtualized machine VMware, so to say, was actually in the about 2000, where I start working on VMware workstation. I think the reason to virtualize is that you know, on the physical host, we can have multiple environment for us to play with, and it is really popular during that time, because as a developer and a infrastructure guy myself, you know, I toy around with different OSs, different application. So it was really important for us to have, you know, to be able to virtualize our environment to play around with different kinds of OS and application. Okay, so this is kind of a little bit of definition of what virtualization is. It's taking a physical server, and with the help of virtualization software, you know, you partition the server, and so that it can appear as several virtual servers, and you can then play around with it and install whatever you want, and you know, without having to going out to buy more physical servers. Okay, that's the reason why most people virtualize. In fact, now I think well, there are still people running physical servers, but I think the smaller companies are running physical servers. The reason is that you know, if you need one server, you are not going to virtualize the server, so you just run on physical machine. But if you have two or more server, I think it's still good to virtualize, because you know, you don't have to buy too many servers in that way. Okay, the benefits of virtualization definitely is to save money on IT costs. Fewer servers means less money needed to maintain them. Space as well. I think the servers in 2000 was pretty huge. Okay, so if you could save on spaces. You know, I used to remember the HP 9000 that I work on was like, wow, it's like two thirds of a rack, you know. And therefore, if you could virtualize it, basically you could save a lot of space as well. And again, with space savings and so on, you also have energy consumption reduction. Virtual machines are also much easier to manage, and migration is also very simple because if you know VMware, for example, it's basically just one single file called VMDK file. So you could just copy the file and move it to another host, EXX host, and that's it, your migration is done. Okay, let's move on to the next, hyper-converged infrastructure and what it is. Okay, basically the first step that people did was mostly to do virtualization, and I think a lot of people are still at the stage of just virtualizing their servers. They are still using a lot of network equipment. They are also using a lot of storage. Yeah, and yeah, this is a diagram that will show you what a traditional is and a hyper-converged is. Okay, on the left of the screen, you will see that the traditional infrastructure, which most people are aware of, you have servers, you have switches, and you have storage. Okay, so basically you will have to invest money on buying many physical servers, connecting them up with the network, and then buying expensive proprietary storage. Okay, so a simple setup like that, even now, simple traditional setup like that, even now, let's say a four machine setup, possibly from Dell with some storage, will be about $180,000. Okay, so basically traditional infrastructure is very expensive. Hyper coverage is what is kind of trendy now. Basically what they do is you see there's actually on the right side there's actually only three servers. Okay, to do hyper converge and to ensure resiliency and redundancy, we need possibly a pair of possibly need about three physical servers to do it. But nowadays physical servers come in one U. And also there are some physical servers with 3U, and basically they have already four servers inside, which is quite interesting as well. So with a 3U, you could actually have a hyper-converged infrastructure in place. That's about 3 inches of rack space, and I think that's really, really neat. Okay, so hyper-converged is the way to go, and the first company that I come across 5 or 6 years ago doing hyper-converged appliance is Nutanix. Okay, but I think now the open source community, including things like Ceph, is already very mature, and I think that likely will eat into VMware and Nutanix kind of domain. Okay, so move on to see what are the benefit. I think the benefit very much is the same as virtualized servers, but now you not only just virtualize the servers, you virtualize the storage and virtualize the network as well. And I think basically storage and network equipment are very expensive. So in terms of cost savings, it's tremendous. It's kind of pretty huge. Okay, so also you save more space. Typically you save about 2/3 of the space. And that also reduce your energy consumption by quite a bit. Okay, because it's a hyper-converged, management is very easy. It's a single pane of glass. Yeah, migration will be similar because most of the hyper-converged environment, do have virtualized environment. So it's still like copying one file and moving it to another hyper-converged infra. Okay, let's move on to the next one. Okay, we move on to the underpinnings of cloud. Okay, I think moving from virtualized server to hyperconverged, and then basically, you know, now I think everybody is running cloud. So we need to know what really, you know, is cloud. What is the difference between cloud and a hyperconverged environment? Okay, so the important component in the cloud, basically, you know, pool resources that is available to any subscriber. Okay, that means pool resources in terms of storage, in terms of CPUs, in terms of RAM, in terms of network devices. You know, you have a common pool that users can use on the fly. Okay, of course, to be able to enable cloud, you need to have a virtualized environment. And this will help, you know, increase the utilization of your hardware asset. With the cloud, there's elasticity. You can scale up, scale down, and, you know, very fast. I think in, you know, later when Corey do a demonstration, you can see that it's really fast to spin up a server. Okay, also automation, where you build, deploy, configure, provision, move, or all automatically and all via self-service. Okay, so the user is himself, right? Likely just a normal user who learns a little bit on the cloud interface will be able to deploy their own server. You know, they don't need IT or IT infrastructure guy or vendor to do, you know, setup of servers and all that anymore. They could just, with a couple of click, you know, provision a server for their own use. Okay, the last defining factor of the cloud is the metered billing, which means it's a pay-per-use model. You know, the more you use, the more you pay. And if you don't need so much in terms of storage and so on, I think it's a good idea to do housekeeping. Otherwise, the cost will always be going up. Okay, this is an infrastructure view of the cloud. As probably most of you are aware, cloud are built mainly on OpenStack. Okay, as you can see here, OpenStack, this is the OpenStack project. There are many projects in OpenStack, but the important one that probably you guys want to know about is that of the Nova. The Nova is the computing capability. Okay, Neutron is the networking capability. And Ceph, which is not here, yeah, is the storage capability. Okay, of course, there are other different storage projects, including Shift and Cinder as well. Okay, for identity management, they have Keystone. And the interface that you all will see later on in Corey's demo is actually the Horizon project. Okay, Hayong, any questions from the floor at present moment before I continue?
No, not for now.
Okay.
We can continue first.
Thank you. Move on then. Okay, then it comes to the questions of public or private cloud. Back, I think in 2008 or 2009, HP actually was looking at private cloud. But private cloud done by a huge enterprise like HP, you know, it's not cheap. And therefore, competitors like AWS, you know, and Microsoft, Google were able to come in and capture the market, you know. And if you know it now, there are a lot of big public cloud providers, but actually not many big or absolutely no big private cloud provider. Okay, so let's look at the pro and cons of the public cloud. Pro, definitely highly scalable because they have massive pool of resources for usage. It's cheaper than build your own private cloud. They can do disaster recovery across continent. It's reliable and flexible. Okay, and possibility to, I think one of the pro here should not be here, or the cloud migration, because in big public cloud, you can't really do physical to virtual migration. Okay, the con is basically it's very expensive. If you start using the cloud, you realize that the VMs are not expensive, but when you start drawing a lot of data from them, you know, the bandwidth charge is really expensive. Okay, the con, of course, is less secure than private cloud, and also lack of customization that you can do for private cloud. Okay, but anyway, guys, look here, the cloud migration, it shouldn't be here, okay? I will take it out later in the slides. Okay, what is the pro and cons of private cloud? Okay, basically it's exclusivity. Most private cloud provider can define dedicated zone, you know, for individual tenant. So you have, 100% dedicated hardware for your use. In terms of IT security and policy, you have a better security, and customer can actually choose their own security appliance. They don't have to be restricted by the security appliance provided by big cloud providers. Okay, flexibility in terms of connectivity. Most private cloud you can connect via MPLS, leased circuit, or any kind of connections that you may have in mind. Okay, in terms of customization also, it's easier. If you look at public cloud, they only give you a number of flavors of operating systems. Okay, and that may not suit your corporation. So basically for private cloud, you can package any kind of operating systems and any version that you want, and be allowed to provision that on the private cloud. Okay, the point of the cloud migration, I think I just copy and paste to the public cloud. Okay, private cloud, there's an added advantage in terms of migration, because we are able to do virtual to virtual migration. We are also able to do physical to virtual migration. So you don't have to, like, you know, if you are going to migrate to public cloud, you definitely need to, reinstall your application, reinstall your backup and all that, from scratch. Whereas if you go for a private cloud, the migration can be quite simple. Just doing a virtual to virtual or physical to virtual migration. Okay, private cloud cons. If you try to build your own private cloud, it's very expensive. Okay, because you have to do all the hardware investment, whether it be server, whether it be networking devices and so on, it's really expensive. But the key point that a lot of people wouldn't be building their own is that you require, highly skilled professional to build and maintain a cloud. Okay, people like Corey, he's in this field for 15 years, and he's built many public and private cloud. So it's not a skill that, someone could acquire basically in, 1 or 2 weeks or 1 or 2 years. It takes a lot of time. Okay. Of course, private cloud is less flexible than the public cloud, because in terms of scale and it's much smaller, And that's why it's kind of a little bit less flexible than the public cloud. Okay, so let's look at the future of computing. Okay, I think hyperconverged cloud infrastructure, everyone is aware how it's going to go. But the future of computing actually belongs to a group called the cloud native applications. Okay, I'm not going to read through the entire slide, you know, but I'm going to take out a few key points in terms of what is cloud native architecture. One very important concept is DevOps. And DevOps refers to things like infrastructure as a service. You no longer install so-called applications or maybe middleware component, for example. Everything is deployed as a code. Okay, so you write the code, test the code, and you deploy the packages using code. That's why it's called DevOps. Okay. And the defining factors is things like containerized microservices. In traditional application, everything is written in a big, you know, multiple libraries and compile, you know, including application which we are very familiar with, which we have been working with customer a long time, like SAP. SAP is considered a monolithic application because, you know, there are lots of libraries and all of them are kind of packaged together into, you know, multiple packages. And these are really huge package. So that is not cloud native application. Cloud native applications actually comprises of many thousands of small microservices packaged together to create apps. Okay. We recently, I think last year, we worked on a cloud native application, a software as a service for bookkeeping. The defining factor of this is that, you know, we don't have to down the system at all. You know, we have continuous integration and we have continuous delivery of code. Okay, basically we do not need to shut down a server, plan for upgrade and things like that, because that can be very tough for big platforms like, for example, Instagram. You know, they can never find a time where they can say, okay, I'm going to shut down Instagram for 12 hours and, you know, do all the patching and things like that. Okay, so Instagram, Facebook, for example, they are so-called cloud native applications, and most of it is written on microservices, okay, where they can continuously patch the servers, introducing minor upgrades and so on, without having to take down the entire system. Okay, and one additional benefit of containerized microservices is this. You don't have to worry too much about scaling, and you don't have to worry about, you know, whether your particular microservices is running well or not, because what happens if one of your microservices is overloaded? The orchestration platform, they can actually spin up more of those microservices so that they will in effect balance out the load. Okay, so fantastic, it's a fantastic kind of way to scale. Okay, let's move on to the next one. Okay, this is a typical cloud native application. You will see that it's usually Docker or Kubernetes, and everything is actually microservices, right? And cloud native application usually is developed without session, so it's sessionless, and they actually run on serverless infra as well. Okay. So yeah, let me move on to probably my last slide. Okay, as you can see over here, well, there are thousands of at least over here, it looks like there may be hundreds of projects, you know, that is working towards cloud native applications. I think the you can go to the website like CCNF, I think, to look at all these different projects. Okay, they have for cloud native, the way to monitor cloud native application is very different from so-called traditional applications, but they do have a project called Prometheus that is actually very good in monitoring all the microservices and also looking at performance and things of that nature. Okay, I think just now you saw OpenStack one was not too many projects, right? So for cloud native one, you see there are very much project and the trend is towards doing cloud native, because end of the day, you don't have to take down a system to do maintenance, you know, and you can continuously add on features to your application without taking down the entire website, so to say. Yeah, I think with that, I probably can end my session. And thanks for, you know, listening to me, and I'll pass you back to Ha-Yong.
Okay, thank you very much, Tin-Yao, for great speech. Okay. Okay, so we would like to take 5 minutes break from now on. We will continue our webinar after our 5 minutes break, which will be OpenStack demo by Corey. So please do come back by 11:22. And if you have any questions during this break time, please leave us comments on the Q&A session. I will see you later. Thank you. Okay, so I believe everyone is back from the break. So now I will pass to our speaker, Corey, to present a demo of OpenStack.
Okay, let's share that screen. Leon, can you just confirm you can see that screen for me?
Yep, you can see the screen.
Sorry, yes, sure.
Okay, great. Welcome, everybody. So my demonstration today is going to be fairly brief, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to log into the OpenStack cluster that we've set up at Accrets, and we're going to spin up a virtual machine, and it's going to go through the process of installing a web server and setting up a very basic website all from scratch. And with any luck, that will take about 70 seconds to provision. So the point of this is to show you the self-service portal and how easy it is to manage the infrastructure on an IaaS platform like this. So I'm just going to hit up their website. I'm going to log in with a just a basic user account. Does it go? So as a user logging into the system, I can see a little bit of an overview of the resources that I've used. Given this is a demo account, I've got no instances currently created, and I've got sort of no CPUs or RAM allocated out. I do have a volume sitting there apparently. So that you can use this to get a very good overview of your account, how it's sitting, how much resources you're using, and just generally understand your infrastructure. I'm going to go in here to the instances section, and you can see I've got nothing pre-provisioned, so there's no tricks. This is going to be absolutely live. So I'm going to go launch instance, and this is going to guide me through the process of creating a new instance or virtual machine. Virtual machine and instance, the same thing, just a slightly different wording. So we're going to call it a web server. And at this point, I get to choose what operating system I want to use. Now, for this demo account, we've just made available a handful of operating systems. You can see we've got Windows Server 2019, Windows Server 2016, a couple of flavors of Ubuntu and CentOS. So for the purposes of this demo, I might use good old Ubuntu 18. And it's now asking me how bigger would I like the volume. So I'm just going to use the default, say 3 gigs sounds good. We're going to have a 3 gigabyte operating system volume. That's fine. I now get to choose my flavor. So if you're using Hyper-V or VMware on site, you know, usually you can sort of free type and say, I would like 6 CPUs and 12 gig of RAM. When you're using a cloud-based infrastructure, it's a little more rigid in that you've got these predefined flavor types, but the cloud operators or the Accrets team can absolutely specify this. So if you've got a requirement for something that is not in this list, it's relatively easy for the administrators to create something in here for you. But we try and make sure we've got a good selection available. So we're going to use something with, say, 2 CPUs and 4 gig of RAM today. I can have a very complex infrastructure set up if I want. So at this point, I would choose which networks I would like my VM to be connected to, given that I only have one basic network, and that's just the single LAN available. Horizon's gone ahead and selected that for me. We don't need to choose any network ports. It's going to create them for us. At this point, we're not going to apply any security groups. We'll come back to that. Key pair. So by default in cloud, and particularly in OpenStack, security is absolutely first and foremost. So we're going to use a key pair to secure our instance, which means that by default, none of these images have password-based authentication enabled. So if you try and SSH in with a username and password, it won't work. You need to use a key pair. We can certainly work around that, and you can change those defaults, but secure by default is how things are configured here. So this is the just a basic SSH, private key, public key type setup. And what I'm going to do here is the customization script. So if I just click launch instance now, it's going to build me a just bog standard Ubuntu VM with nothing on it. But given that it's a cloud environment, we've got the ability to be able to provision it. So in this customization script section, we can literally put almost anything we like. And I've got prepared here just a basic little script, which I'll show you. And all this is going to do is So it's going to create a username and password for us. So we will be able to log into this VM with SSH username and password. It's going to set some parameters around that. So password expiry, SSH password, etc. We're going to do a package update. So this is just an apt update to make sure we pull down the latest packages. I've commented out the apt upgrade. So if I enable this, the operating system will go and do a full upgrade of its OS and all the packages and everything. That works fine, but it just takes an extra 2 or 3 minutes. So I've just commented that out. And we're going to install Nginx, so obviously a basic little web server. And then we're going to write out a file, a very simple little website here that's not going to do a whole lot, but it'll just prove that it's working. And so we're just going to write that file out here. Now, if you had a Git repo with a functional website, you know, it could be a very complex or a very simple website. In this script, we could put in the relevant commands to clone that Git repo and do the npm initializations or whatever it is that you need to do and stand up a fully functional website. And then right at the end, it's going to echo out a little command. It's going to say the system is finally up after X number of seconds, and just a bunch of X's makes it really easy to find in the logs. And that's it. I can hit launch instance. And with any luck, this is a live system and not a pre-recorded demo, so anything could go wrong, but it should be fine. So with any luck, this web server will spin up. We'll go see it progress through, so block device mapping, creating the hard disks, whatnot, and then we'll see that run. Okay, that's how long it takes to provision a VM. That VM is now running. We can click here and we can click console, and one of the huge benefits using OpenStack over some of the larger public cloud providers is that we actually get access to the console. So as the machine's booting, we can see it booting. So we can see it go through the BIOS steps or pre-booting steps. This is particularly helpful if you're using complex Windows workloads. You know, sometimes Windows might blue screen or you need to press F8 and go into safe mode to do various operations. That is absolutely not an option on a lot of public cloud infrastructure as a service platforms. But with OpenStack, we get access to the actual console. And so we can pretty much do anything to this VM we like, which is really helpful. So you can see it going through the boot process there on the screen. It takes a little while to initialize. And here we've got our log, which is the serial output. So by default, the cloud images all output their status to the serial port. Obviously, that's more of a Linux thing than a Windows thing. Windows certainly can do it. But we can see streaming out here is a log of what the server's doing as it boots up. Fantastic. And we can see it going through our initialization process. So we can see cloud init. And anybody who's familiar with Linux, you can see that's doing an apt update, pulling down the most recent package versions. And now we can see it installing Nginx. Great. It's going through that Nginx installation process, which is just an apt install Nginx. It's provisioned our SSH keys. And here's our little message. It says the system is finally up after 74 seconds. So that took from us pressing the button to that website being live, that was a total of 74 seconds. And that website is now running on this server. So how do we access it? Well, at the moment, you can see here that the IP address of this web server is 192.168.1.192. Now, obviously, I can't access that because I'm not on the same network. So we're going to need to give this server a public IP address, which is pretty simple. We just hit associate floating IP. And we have a list here of the public IPs that are available to us. If we exhaust that list, we can just press this little button here and request an additional address be allocated to us. Obviously, public IPs are a little bit scarce, so we don't allocate our customers any more than they need, but they can self-service their own requests there. So I've got a public IP address there. I'm going to hit associate, and that's going to do a one-to-one NAT mapping on our router. So anything that hits the public IP is going to be NATed through to our private IP. So our public IP is this one here, 210.57, blah, blah, blah. I'm just going to copy that, go into a command prompt, and I'm going to try and ping that address. That'll be negative T. Now, nothing. That is not working. And if I try and hit up our website, that is also not working because security by default. So everything is locked down unless you, the administrator, specifically unlock it. So this web server is secure. There's no ports allowed in. In order for me to be able to get access in, I need to adjust the firewall, which in OpenStack is called a security group. And I've created just a predefined security group rule here, which is allowing ICMP and HTTP inbound. And if I apply that and press save, that firewall rule will be applied to the router straight away. There we go. We can see those pings come alive straight away. And straight away that website is loaded. So there we go. There's our little website running. So it's welcome to Accrets. There's a web server built by a simple script, which you can see is the command that we had here. So that's fully provisioned a web server. Now it's a very simple example, but that could be significantly more complex and it would have taken a similar amount of time. I've provisioned this through the Horizon user interface today, but if I wanted to automate this process, I could very easily do this exactly the same process using the API or the CLI tools. So we could have some automation or scheduling happen, you know, maybe a Jenkins job that goes and spins up a server for us upon a new build of or a new set of code being pushed to master, anything along those lines. If you can imagine it, you can do it. There's really little restrictions with what we can achieve with the OpenStack platform. That's about the end of my demonstration, but I'll be happy to take any questions now or later, but I'll pass back to Hoyong.
Sorry, Corey. Before you go, can you show us the language option?
Yeah, absolutely. So given that this is open source, we can configure this any which way we like. And one of the customizations that the team at Accrets have done is enable or extended the internationalization options in Horizon. You can see it's going to default to English by default. But as a user, I can go in and choose the language that I would like my console to present in, the time zones and whatnot. So we've got a good selection of languages here, and Chinese is one of the ones that the Accrets team have added. So if I hit save, everything in this UI is going to change. There we go. So all of these, that should be instances, hopefully. I can't read that, but there we go. So we can see everything has now changed across to that language. That language will persist until the user change that back. So I'm just going to change that back to English, hopefully. There we go. Yep, English, save.
Thank you, Corey. Thank you for that.
No worries. Okay, that's the end of my little demo. Hopefully that was insightful.
Yes, thank you very much, Corey. So maybe for Q&A sessions, I will hand over to Joshua. So we will start on our Q&A session now.
All right, I will facilitate the Q&A segment. Okay, the first question we have I think it's addressed to Teng Yao. You mentioned about applications. Which applications would you recommend for private cloud and which would you recommend for public cloud?
Yeah, I think now for the private cloud, most providers are still able to provide just infrastructure as a service. So that will take care of almost 90% of all applications, okay? But there are new applications that people are developing, things that, very good for DevOps and so on. These are cloud-native applications, and I think cloud-native applications may be better suited to do the public cloud, okay? Where you can basically scale up, scale down. But I think there's a lot of workload currently that's in public cloud that should have been on private cloud. Things like, for example, if you have your own enterprise resource systems or your own intranet and so on that you're not going to provide to the public, this could be good use cases for private cloud. Yeah, I hope it answers the questions, Joshua.
The next question, user say, in our organization, we are already using server virtualization. I've heard people mention about on-premise cloud. What can be the additional benefits of using this?
Okay, so if you look at private cloud, I mean, even for our Accrets private cloud, we have a hosted version. We also can provide on-premise version as well. The advantage of having on-premise, especially if you're going to reprovision your old hardware, then the cost, can be very affordable because all our OpenStack cloud is built on open source. Okay, and the cost of all this open source software, besides, you know, getting effort from professional people to set it up and maintain it, the cost could be quite affordable. So for example, for VMware on premises, you may have to pay, let's say per instance, depend on CPU and all that. Maybe for licensing per month, you may have to pay $30, $40 US. Okay. For on-premises private cloud like Accrets, you could probably be just half of it, half of the pricing in terms of so-called licensing fee. Okay, and you also probably have better support than public cloud, because public cloud, basically your only means of support is through either forum or through email. Okay, a private cloud provider, depending on, you know, your subscription with them, are probably able to provide more well-rounded support than the public cloud provider. Joshua, okay. Does that answer your questions?
Yeah, I hope it answers our questions from the attendee. Okay, I have one more question from an attendee here. It's interesting to see that your portal can support many languages because I have users, many users from different countries in my organization. So I see that you have Chinese. I also have, maybe I see that some other languages that it can support. I'm just curious whether this portal defaults to the visitor's web browser language or something else. Maybe could I request Corey to address that question?
Yep, absolutely. So Horizon will default to English, but it's open source, so we can configure absolutely anything. We can certainly get it to base it on a user. It's based on the user profile setting, so we could change the user profile setting for them by default when we provision the account. But no, it will not detect the user's browser language. It will default to English unless it's told otherwise, and then it will be persistent from then on. So as an administrator, when I create a new user, if they are in Germany, then I can set their language to German, and they will always have German, and so on and so forth.
Okay, I think that is the last of the question on How many compute resource in OpenStack provision among the workloads to prevent issue relating to performance lag?
Okay, so maybe this one Corey can answer, but I think usually for public cloud is you know, the ratio of actual CPU versus virtual CPU. I think if I'm not wrong, is it about 5, Corey?
Yeah, different vendors will do different contention ratios, and they'll also potentially do different contention ratios depending on the flavor type that you select. So you can get CPU optimized flavor types, in which case the contention ratio is lower and potentially the CPU clock speed is higher. But in OpenStack specifically, the question says how many compute resources in OpenStack provision amongst the workloads to prevent issues related to performance lag. OpenStack's completely configurable. So if it's a on-prem private cloud and you wanted one-to-one contention because your workload was sensitive to CPU, then you can do that. If your workload is not CPU sensitive and you wanted to do 1-to-100 contention, that is okay too. It's completely configurable.
Right. Oh, there's one more question. Can AI model train on private cloud?
Yeah. Okay. So maybe let me answer that question. I think AI model, if you are just looking at CPU, is definitely possible to put you know, Python on it. As I think most AI people will want to use Jupyter notebook. This is possible. But if you are going to use a GPU, then you know, likely you will have to have some different kind of setup, because GPU basically will have a problem in terms of sharing with virtual machines. Okay, so that is possible with VMware, if I'm not wrong. That means sharing. If you are using the VMware stack you possibly can share the GPU amongst several virtual machines. Okay, I hope that answered the questions.
I can just jump in there and further to that. Obviously, a lot of the people watching might be familiar with, say, Amazon and Azure. They all have GPU-enabled flavor types, so they are considerably more expensive than the standard flavor types, but you get access to a shared, generally a NVIDIA, Tesla, or equivalent GPU. Again, if you're doing private cloud, if you had a lot of AI training requirements and you wanted to GPU enable your private cloud, absolutely you can. That is completely supported within OpenStack. You need to make sure that your hardware is capable. You can't just put a GDX 1080 in and then split it up across VMs. But as long as you put in the right model of GPU, and that's generally the NVIDIA Tesla range, we can pass those shared GPUs through to the VMs, and you can do AI training. There's a lot of use cases around people using OpenStack for that.
Okay, I think that's the last of our question. I think we also about 3 minutes past our webinar ending time. So I'll hand over to Ha Yong.
Okay, so this is end of our webinar. I really thank you for attending to our webinar, and thank our speakers, Ting Yao and Corey again. So if you have any further questions, or if you like to, you can actually visit our website, which is on accrets.com, or you can email us at info@accrets.com. Also, from our website, if you go to onaccrets.com, we do prepare a demo for you to try out our OpenStack. So if you're interested in it, please go to our website onaccrets.com and click on demo on the homepage. It will be highlighted on the yellow, and you will be able to try out our OpenStack. So that's all for our webinar today. I really appreciate that you attended our webinar today. So if you have any questions, please feel free to email us or visit our website. Thank you very much and have a great day.
Thank you. Bye.